Welcome to the Creative Community. I'm your host, David Starkey, and my guest this time is artist Dane Goodman. Dane, welcome.
It's great to be here. Thank you. Good to see you again.
Yeah, after 9 years.
After 9 years. Yeah. We keep doing this every 9 years.
Right, right. Well, we ran into each other the other day, and we're kind of catching up. I had known you pretty well. I see you pretty often at Santa Barbara City College, where we used to work, and I still do, when you were directing the Atkinson Gallery. And I always knew you also as a really brilliant and idiosyncratic artist, you know, and someone with a level of attention to detail that was unmatched. And I know that that goes with your art, but as we'll see, it also goes in the way you think of your whole art project when you're putting together a show, right?
Yeah, I'm old enough to have sort of had a career in the arts. And my undergraduate degree is actually in art education. Mm-hmm. I went out and taught high school before I went to graduate school and all that, but I ended up in the museum world. And I worked at the Santa Barbara Museum of Art for almost 19 years. And I ended up being the designer for all the exhibitions and the coordinator of all the exhibitions. Then I went to City College and I took care of that gallery as a director there. Mm-hmm. But during all of that time, all of these years, I've always been an artist. I've been exhibiting at a fairly good level in my works in museum collections, that kind of thing. So, but all of that work, I think, has helped me in my exhibitions.
Yeah, and I think there's a little bit of a parallel to what I do, teaching creative writing than being a creative writer. And sometimes I know it can be frustrating to teach creative writing. I'm sure it can be to put on a show for someone else. But what specifically do you think feeds into your artistic process when you're working on both sides of the aisle, as it were?
Well, you learn both what to do and what not to do. Mm. And you see people, they'll do things and you go, like, well, I hadn't thought of that. But then you'll see people do these things and you're just kind of inside your head,
your head
going, like, shouldn't have done that.
Right.
But again, you know, when you do this for year after year, you begin to have some fairly, I think, level-headed notions about how things can happen, how things could look. Mm-hmm. And a lot of it is really basic, but most people don't have to deal with that kind of thing.
When you get to our age, you know, get to a certain age, do you sort of feel, I mean, I think artists are more adventurous maybe than writers in many cases, but do you feel like, I do this really well, I should stick to this? Or are you always looking for ways to kind of smash that up and go do something else?
Oh, yeah. I've always been, I always do a range of things. And so for me, that's just who I am and the way I work. And this show that I did that we'll talk about, you'll see this range. I'm always interested in new materials, new ways to approach things. I've never let it go that I had to focus in on one thing. And early on in my career, I thought that was a problem because, well, galleries wouldn't like it. They would like you to do one thing, so they have something to sell. But in the span of things, I think for me it's worked out well because it actually shows my range of interest.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's go. We have some images from your work, and if we can go to the very first one, it's a beautiful boat, and tell us a little bit about this because it's got a kind of a bittersweet story.
Yeah, well, last time you and I did this, Keith Puccinelli was here, and we were talking about this project that we had done together. We did all these trace monotype prints, and then I suppose it was like maybe 6 years later, we did this large project at the Westmont Museum where we had a lot of collaborative drawings and sculptures, but the main thing in the show was this boat. And the title of the show is Tug. And tug is to be used as a noun and also as a verb, how we tug on one another and things pull you one way or the other. So we built this boat out in Carpinteria in this big building because it's 25 feet long and 12 feet high and 6 feet wide. And it's lit from the inside. But as is Keith and I one thing we've always liked is common materials. So while there's a lightweight wooden interstructure, it's basically, there's a layer of plastic, and then it's only cellophane and duct tape.
Cellophane and duct tape, yeah. Okay.
So it's like common, really common materials. You can buy at the hardware store.
It looks like a beautiful work of stained glass from here.
Well, that's kind of what it was, but it's fairly wacky because as you walk around the boat, it's kind of... It does these kind of
it's
things.
It's not seaworthy, you're saying.
But it was, Keith and I were very, very happy about that piece. It was something like we would have never done separately. Mm-hmm. You know, I came up with a general idea and made a little maquette, and I showed it to Keith, and he really liked it. But then, of course, he added his great touches and all this angularity and things. So I just wanted to show that because that's kind of like... the last with Keith and I. Yeah.
Well, and we lost Keith. That was a devastating
for you, obviously.
2 years
ago, almost right now, yeah.
What was it about your collaboration, your partnership, that maybe brought out the best of each of you?
Well, I think there was a lot of mutual respect. I totally admired Keith. When I was running the gallery, I gave him a solo show, and I've said for years, and I say it again now, I would be happy to do an exhibition of his drawings at any museum in the world. Mm-hmm. I believe that strongly about him. And he was a unique human being. We hit it off, similar ages. He grew up in the Bay Area, I grew up in sort of Illinois, Chicago area, had very similar interest in music. Mm-hmm. We had our fantastic wives, you know, mm-hmm. Who were good friends. And we lost Fran just 9 months before Keith died. So it was very devastating. But yeah, there was just, we had a little bit of a maverick streak mm-hmm. in both of us that kind of seemed to work well.
There was a little nose thumbing every once in a while. That's good.
Well, it was like part of it, especially with Keith's work, is a way to get doing something that appears to be funny to draw people in to point out some very tough stuff. Mm-hmm. And we did that repeatedly. Yeah. So you have to kind of pay attention. It's mm-hmm. not just exactly what you see mm-hmm. on the surface. You know?
So the show that we're going to look at is 40 years worth of work.
It's selections from 40 years.
Let's maybe we can take a look at the first slide that we have here.
The first image should show like a general shot of the room. I think it's kind of a wide angle. This is at the University of California here in Santa Barbara at the College of Creative Studies Gallery. And the director, Dan Connolly, just a wonderful artist and human being, had invited me to do a show there. And I had been thinking that there was so much work that I have that had never actually been seen that that's what I wanted to show. So what I did was I picked out 10 groups of work that go back as late as 1978, then up to 2018, works that were made for the show. And there ends up being about like 190, maybe 192 works in the show. Mm. And maybe 150 of those had never been seen.
Wow.
So part of it was like I wanted the public to see that, but mostly I wanted to be able to see this all in one space.
Right, right.
And see what kind of connections might filter through to me, too.
And what were those connections?
Well, one thing that's undeniable is your own hand. Mm-hmm. As Marie talks about her drawings as being autographs, and you see that, the works will look very different, some of them completely different. You couldn't even believe, it's like having 10 artists in a group exhibition. But there's a commonality, I think, about attitude. Mm-hmm. It's throughout the work. And again, unusual use of materials, belief in certain aspects of drawing, that all plays through. And what we can do is kind of walk around the show and just see some installation shots, and then come back and look at individual works, and then I can talk about each of those.
Let's take a look at the next image. So when you say attitude, what's the attitude that?
Well, I hope there's a curiosity that people, when they see the show, that they thought that you know. Most people would show one thing mm-hmm. And then expand on that one idea. What I'm showing is this kind of roaring curiosity about a lot of things. Mm-hmm. And I came to terms with that a long time ago, that that's who I was and that I wasn't going to be pigeonholed in any one thing. And if I had an idea, that the idea was important to go out and do. Mm-hmm. And whether to think about how it fits in terms of like sales or anything.
Let's hold on this image if we can for just a second, because I can see four separate things going on, right? I mean, I see these pieces on the wall. I see a big sculpture on the floor.
Yeah.
I see another one to the right. And then I see, I'm not sure if those are lithographs or whatever.
No, well, they're actually paintings on paper.
Okay.
Well, in the show, all 10 of these sets of work, each has pretty much like a two-dimensional set of things and then an object with it.
Gotcha.
So it's a sculpture and two-dimensional because I always work that way.
Okay.
Let's
The
space has got some little funny things that I had to deal with, but because of my history of being like exhibition designer, I made a complete floor plan for this, and it was nailed down to the inch. So when I went in to do the show,
you knew exactly where stuff went.
I knew exactly where it went, literally, and I was well prepared, and I got it installed way ahead of time. But it was really joyful to me to not be under any pressure, or that it was all about my work and installing it the way I wanted to, and in the speed and manner that which I, because I conceive of this show as a single artwork.
Mm-hmm.
Even though there are all these different groups of work, the way I approach it is like when that first shot was up, when you walk into a space, there's a sensation that you should get. And you should want to like, I mean, you should, as a designer, the goal would be like, oh, this looks fabulous. This is really cool. But then you have to like get past that and get to each work.
Mm-hmm.
So basically, when you walk into that space, and you could look around, and you could see the show, and you could walk out. But I was hoping that it would encourage people, they'd be drawn
in.
And it's kind of like, at least my brain, seeing all of that, because it's all coming from me, so you're standing in the room, you're seeing all those things. It was kind of like seeing the way I think I am in reality.
Yeah. That makes me think, too, when as a poet, when I'm getting my poems together in a collection, I can say, oh, this is what I do. This was good, but I frequently, I don't know if you feel this way, I'll feel like, damn, I thought I had achieved more, or what is it? What's missing? I guess I can sort of briefly revel in, you know, this success here or that. I'm always feeling like that didn't quite get what I was looking for.
Are you talking about your like an individual poem?
No, I'm just talking about my oeuvre overall. You know, like what I'm always feeling like there's something more out there that I haven't quite reached, and I maybe don't even know how to articulate what it is.
Well, I think that's the reason we do it.
Yeah, because we're looking for that.
Maybe if we'd done the perfect thing,
we could quit.
Let's quit and go play guitar.
That's right.
So, I'm trying to be less. I'm highly critical, especially of my work, and I've kind of let go of that because when I put all this together, it is what it is.
Right.
And the other thing is, the audience that comes to see it always respond to it in a fashion that it's out of your control.
Sure.
And so, like your poem, somebody could read your poem and just be, this is the best thing they've ever read, right?
Next person is.
Well, you really.
That's out of your control.
And the other thing is, I edited out a lot of works for this show. There are a lot of other things I could have put in the show, so I felt reasonably good about what was in the show.
Right.
So you
had so much control.
This was the most recent work in the show. What it is in front. There's a sculpture on a pedestal, and there's a head at the bottom. But actually, it's one of our Christmas trees, family's Christmas tree that I've saved. To carve on. So I carved this head, I trimmed off all the branches, and where the branches were, I colored each one. So it has a certain kind of animated quality. And then, of course, when we had the tree upright, I could tune it so it was straight. And when I put it on there,
I
thought,
crooked.
Look at that. But I actually liked it.
I love it because, you know, it looks like a chronometer of some sort.
Yes.
You know,
yeah.
It's getting hot or whatever. Yeah.
You know, metronome. So behind it are 40, I think there's 44 paintings. It's a little hard to see here. They're paintings that I did on the inside of cereal bags. Shredded wheat cereal bags.
Okay, so you took the bag out, you emptied
I kept collecting them.
Right.
And then what I would do, I mean, people thought I just painted on top of the bags, but I didn't. I'd open the bottom,
right.
and I'd stick brushes inside and paint in layers.
You're painting inside?
Yeah, literally inside like this. So it was very messy. And I purposely set up that problem because I would have to lose some control.
A lot.
I couldn't do it. And things also have to be done in layers. In other words, if you want the most prominent thing, the nose, the eyes, and all these
things.
That's
first, right?
You have to do these things, and you have to remember to do these things. And then, of course, to be able to do them with some rapidity, I would have to stick a hairdryer in there and dry it in layers and do those. So while when you...
Well, that's wild because it's the opposite of the way a painting normally goes on canvas. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, there is a painting history of people painting on glass, a reverse painting, and I'm aware of that. But I just wanted to do something. I've always wanted to do a bunch of heads, and then I had that head on the sculpture. The title for that piece is just like tree head, but what's behind it is called rank and file. Mm-hmm. It's like we're all the rank and file. So it was to indicate that this could sort of go on and on.
So let me backtrack just a moment to it. It says cereal box because our viewers are watching the video. That's a wacky artist thing is to be inside a cereal bag, empty cereal bag. I mean, did you pull it out once and say this looks sort of like a head? Or?
Well, actually, the material itself kind of came from Keith Puccinelli. He had, we had done this project where we're making pajamas, and he came over and he had made one that had this clear plastic, and he had painted tomatoes on it. And I thought it was great. And he said, I cut up some cereal bags to do that. I said, did you paint on the outside or the inside? He said, on the outside. And of course, me being in the museum, I'm thinking, that's going to scratch off. So I just said, well, would it work if I did it this other way? And I did like five of these in 2013, and I liked them, but I put them away. And then last year, about this time, I revisited that, and I just made all these other ones. Yeah. But see, I'm very, and you'll see other materials here. I'm really interested in these materials that we all have some commonality with, and they're humble. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not bronze.
Right, right. Well, let's take a look at the next one. And as we go to this next image, I'm curious too. Where do you keep all this stuff? You guys must have a big garage.
No, well, I have my studio, and it just gets smaller and smaller as years go back. But if you notice, almost all these works are on paper.
Okay, so
and I've got like seven flat files.
Yeah. This, so what do we got? Yeah.
Well, this is a piece called Lyle and Grace, and it's not Grace with a capital G. It's just the word Grace. And it was about Marie's father when he died. I showed this at what's now the Museum of Contemporary Art here in Santa Barbara. And about a week or two after he died, I just started making these works. And I made about 110 of them. These really flowed out of me. And it was about my memories of basically his body becoming more emaciated and certain actions and things I saw him do. And some were just invented. And it was very poignant, cathartic work for me to do. So, and it's tough stuff to look at. When I showed it at the museum, you know, people came in and cried. It's very powerful. So anyway, it was all about him. And then on the next slide, there's a close-up. Coming out from one of the heads is this bed. It's carved out of soap.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And you can't see how it's suspended from the wall. But it's carved out of a bar of soap. And that is entitled Gone. It's like the person is gone, has left the room kind of thing.
So how did you, I mean, you carved that.
Oh, yeah.
How did you train yourself to carve a bed out of soap and do all this other, I mean, is that just something that you've done over the years?
Yeah, actually, I started showing soap sculptures in the mid-90s, like at Rose Snell's Gallery. And over the years, I've done things with that. Well, the story with it is, my studio at that time was not at home, and I couldn't go back at night, and our daughter was really small, and I started, you know, you give your child baths, and you give them these soaps, and they're like little animals. But after a while, they started becoming abstract, and they started looking like my own sculptures. So I thought, I realized I could actually stay at home in the evening and carve at the kitchen table. And there is another thing I very much like about this fact is that anybody can walk into CVS and buy a bar of ivory soap for whatever, 80 cents, and you can make a work of art. Right. And there's something enormously appealing to me about that.
Right.
That commonality kind of thing. And they've lasted. I've got works from the 90s.
These pieces of soap are still there?
Yeah, I think unless somebody said, well, what if somebody bought one and took a shower with it. I said, oh, it'd be an expensive shower.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's interesting to think, too, though. I mean, anyone can go in and buy this bar of soap, yeah, but they can't make a bed like that. I mean, you know.
Yeah, well, one of the reasons I was able to get that kind of detail is someone gave me, I know it was their father's or their uncle's, dental tools, which have all these funny little hooks things. So that's why I could do these undercuts on the on the bedding. And that was kind of like a quantum leap, yeah.
Well, and I mean, ultimately, though, a bar of soap is going to dissolve, one assumes. It doesn't have the same as a piece of bronze, the same staying power,
no,
right?
No, but if you look at all of my work, I'm not that concerned about that longevity. As a matter of fact, I won't use Keith's exact language, but he would say, what do I care? I'm going to be dead in 20 years. It's like, part of that thing is wrapped up in ego, wanting somehow do you have this huge legacy left behind. Right. And the other thing, all that's been done. Why wouldn't you want to work with something like cereal bags
and soap
and tin foil? Why not work with these materials? And everybody can relate to this. They may not like it, but they know what the material is. I've done paintings on handkerchiefs, on bed sheets, on pillowcases, for the same reason.
Right, and in a way, it's more amazing that you're able to take these ordinary objects and turn them into works of art.
Well, some of those are personal revelations. Like one day, I was thinking about, you know, I had done something on a bed sheet and something on a pillowcase, and I was thinking about a handkerchief. And like how I carry one, because I'm from the Midwest and I'm a certain generation. Right. I still carry it. I have one today. But it just dawned on me, well, it's cotton. Cotton, you know, that's canvas. Mm-hmm. Why can't I paint on this? So it comes with a certain inherent meaning, because it's carried with you. You know, you know this material. So by putting those things together, even soap, this thing that we rub on our body, it's a very intimate thing. It's not neutral.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We only got about 5 minutes left. Okay. I want to make sure that we
get
through everything.
We can just keep running through.
Let's see what we got next from the show. This was how long ago?
Well, about 9 months ago.
9 months ago.
Okay. Yeah, 10, 8, 9.
What are we looking at here?
Yeah, this is a combination piece. The pieces in the back were done maybe 1985, and the sculpture in the front was just done in 2017, something like that. And it's just this odd combination. There's no literalness about this. It's just that I thought they looked terrific together. And one was very tight, and the other one was very organic. Mm-hmm. The piece in the back was just a very simple notion of like, how can I do the most basic idea? So if you look at the piece on the upper left, it was just about like the sun comes up and the sun goes down. So you have this kind of up and down.
Okay.
And then the rest of it is like variations on that theme, but people would come in and say, it's an alphabet.
Yeah, it looks like hieroglyphics or an alphabet of some sort.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And then the sculpture in front of it is actually, it's from this notion I call parcel of privacies. And I realized one day I'd seen this priest who had been talking to somebody, walked away, and I realized how much private information that they had to hold. And it was kind of like seeing somebody walking with a heavy bag on their back. And then I took it a little further, and I realized that we all carry private things, and we carry them for other people. So I've done a number of these things where it's basically like a big bag shape. Yeah.
Let's take a look at the next one.
These were things I'd done in Illinois as an artist residency. They're different images. They're almost, for me, kind of unusual. They're very landscape reference. I had actually was going out and drawing in the field and seeing these things, and then I made large paintings. They're like 3 feet tall. And I call them, this is the Mackinac Quintet, because it was made in the Mackinac Preserve in central Illinois. And then the sculpture in front of it that Westmont owns is, it sort of looks like a fishing lure, you know?
It sure does, a bobber.
And part of all this was because my father, I grew up in central Illinois, and he had fished and hunted in that exact territory. And I had learned how to fish when I was a young kid. And so there's, for me, it's a little bit of a sentimental thing, but again, it's like this juxtaposition of objects against recognizable imagery. Oh, these are the snowman, yeah. I've done a lot of snowman images, as you know.
I do.
But these are a set of drawings that I'm particularly fond of that had never been seen. So I installed those with one of these snowman sculptures, which I think there's a detail of, maybe the next one. I guess not. Anyway, if we could back up to that one. It is made of this children's material called model magic, and you can buy it at a craft store. So again, it's common materials.
Let's take a look at the next one.
This one's a little hard to read, but this, when I used to make a lot of abstract work, these are drawings, and then if you look at the detail, you can see that there's a sculpture standing in front of it, mm-hmm. kind of the same, and it was remarkable for me. I'd never put those drawings together edge to edge like that, and I'd never put the sculpture in front of them, so it was a little bit of a revelation for me.
Just looking at this on the screen, it's gorgeous. It really is stunning.
Yeah, I was happy about that, yeah. This is the earliest piece in the show from 1978 when I was living in New York. And there, it's much more minimal. It's oil stick on paper. I was thinking about shaped canvases and canvas, like that object on the right. You could stand in the space. It could be 12 feet tall and freestand. So it was a way of like looking at painting beyond, you know, normal confines. Oh, this is actually this is a whole sketchbook that I took apart. And there are all these abstract drawings, and then there are corresponding little sculptures at the bottom.
Let's take a look at there's a close-up, I believe, yeah.
Yeah, there's a little close-up, yeah. I did those in Wichita. I was always happy with that sketchbook.
That's beautiful. Yeah. I think we're going to have to come back to the studio now because we've only got a minute left.
Yeah.
It's been fantastic looking at this work. It's been,
great.
You know, great talking to you.
Yeah.
Got 20 seconds left. Any last words of wisdom?
No, it's just that I feel fortunate to be at this point in my life, and I've got a lot of recognition in the last year, so I'm a happy guy.
I'm happy to have you. Thank you so much, Dane.
Thank you.
The Creative Community is produced in Santa Barbara by J.P. Montalvo and his fantastic crew, also with the help of a very generous grant from the Diana and Simon Robb Foundation. I'm David Starkey, and we'll see you next time.